Jesus has triumphed over Satan and death, and now praise his name, I am free. Although he has gone to his Father's right hand, may others see Jesus in me.
Greetings, friends. This is Pastor R. Norheim presenting the first in a series of anniversary broadcasts commemorating 44 years of broadcasting the Lutheran Gospel Hour of Pasadena, California, released on over 70 radio stations in the United States, Canada, and overseas. For many years, we have prepared an anniversary album of choice gospel songs, which we have offered to our radio listeners who send in their anniversary offerings. Cassette tapes are offered to all who prefer those. It Is Morning in My Heart is the first song on this year's album, which Joe Erickson and I sing with Lorin Whitney at the organ. And here it is.
All the darkness of the night has passed away. It is morning in my heart. I am leaving in the sunlight of the day. The gloomy shadows all depart, all depart. Songs of gladness now I sing, for since Jesus is my King, it is morning, it is morning in my heart. I can hear the songbirds singing their refrain. For me begins again. It is morning in my heart. It is morning, it is morning in my heart, in my heart. Jesus made the gloomy shadows all depart, all depart. Songs of gladness now I sing. Since Jesus is my King, it is morning, it is morning in my heart.
And we thank and praise thee, our wonderful Lord and Savior, for causing the sun to rise on these broadcasts down through these 44 years of presenting the gospel in sermon and song, causing many to find the sunshine of God's love in their hearts, already home in glory, others on the way. And we pray thou wilt in a special way bless this anniversary occasion to the glory of your matchless name, Lord Jesus. Amen. This year's anniversary album we are offering for the first time today has for its title From Cross to Crown, and it contains 12 choice gospel songs by Lutheran Gospel Hour singers. The second song on the album, or cassette, is Ho, Everyone That's Thirsty, with Mrs. Norheim and I singing, with Lorin Whitney at the organ.
Thirsty, I will pour floods upon the
message for you. I will pour water on him that is thirsty.
Once a month, our pastor of a Pasadena Emmanuel Lutheran Brethren Church, Jim Jensen, sings one of his favorites. Next week, you'll hear him sing one of his songs included on this year's anniversary album, but we include an extra on today's broadcast with Ron Nelson at the piano. Listen. As earlier announced on today's broadcast, this is the first in a series of anniversary broadcasts commemorating 44 years of broadcasting the Lutheran Gospel Hour, heard on over 70 radio stations in the United States, Canada, and overseas. From Cross to Crown is the title of our 44th anniversary album. It is also available on cassette tape, so you can have your choice if you inform us when you write and send in your generous anniversary offering to help keep the Lutheran Gospel Hour on the air. This offer is limited to United States and Canada. Send your offer to Lutheran Gospel Hour, Post Office Box 12, Pasadena, California, 91102. In Canada, Lutheran Gospel Hour, Post Office Box 201, Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, S7K3K4. Let me repeat the address. You write to Lutheran Gospel Hour, Post Office Box 12, Pasadena, California, 91102. In Canada, Lutheran Gospel Hour, Box 201, Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, S7K3K4. And now, before Associate Willmore Gundersen brings today's message, he sings Precious Lord.
this is Pastor Willmore Gundersen. I'd like to share with you today on the subject of prayer. In doing so, I'd like to take the book of James and look at about four verses. But before we do that, I want to share a little bit about the man who is the author of this book. He was the half-brother of Jesus Christ. He was the son of Mary and Joseph. And the Bible tells us that he didn't believe Jesus to be the Messiah before after the death and the resurrection of Jesus. It says then in 1 Corinthians 15:7 that after the resurrection, Jesus appeared to James. And from that time on, the brothers of Jesus are found with the Jerusalem church as some of the pillars. Now, this book, James, is really the Proverbs of the New Testament. Very little Christian doctrine is found in the book. It's a book of practical, everyday living. How do I live? How do I conduct myself as a believer should? The name Jesus Christ as Lord is only mentioned twice in the first chapter, in the first verse of the second chapter. It's a short book of only five chapters. What he does is he preaches against dead orthodoxy. Well, let's look at the verses in the fifth chapter. From verse 16, we'll read together. Confess your faults or your sins one to another, and pray one for another, that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elias was a man subject to the passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth for a space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the air of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. First of all, then, I'd like us to look at the prayer that we should confess, or prayer of confession. How important it is for us to be honest with both God and man and confess our prayer. Notice, if our prayers are to be answered by God, sin must be dealt with. And let this be etched into your mind and into your heart to everyone listening, where God says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin. Now, if you do not confess your sin, our prayers will not be answered. In fact, the Bible speaks in the book of 1 Peter 3:7 and says our prayers will be hindered even if we don't treat our wives as we should and if we don't show consideration to them or even respect to them as we should. So keep that in mind, men. Notice where there are some people who will take this verse and say, well, it's only to a certain person you're to confess your sin, to a minister, to a pastor, some would say to a priest, and so forth. Notice what he says, one to another. That could be to an elder, that could be to another brother and sister in Christ, but that you confess your sin and ask for help. Notice where the Lord, we might say it this way, Christ has not given a minister power to pardon sin. It is the only true confessional is the divine mercy seat. It's the Lord himself who can give you sins forgiveness. The Bible puts it this way. There's one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. You go to him with your sin, confess your sin to him, and maybe you should also ask someone else to help you, someone else that maybe would sympathize with you in the situation you're in and can understand you and be of help. Please do that. The Bible encourages it. He says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another. And I believe that the Bible teaches all through the scriptures that God is able to forgive all sin. It says in the book of Proverbs 10, verse 12, love covereth all sin. Think of David, who says, I love the Lord because he has heard my voice, and he heard my cry for mercy. Notice now, sin must be confessed before mercy can be given. You have that straight? You cannot receive God's mercy or grace before you deal with your sin. It's impossible. Sin must be confessed and dealt with before mercy can be given. In such an act, love reaches its highest point. And that love includes faith in God, which is the condition of forgiveness. What sin ought we then to forgive? Pardon me. What sin ought we then to confess is what I mean. There are many secret sins of impure thoughts, corrupt desires, and things of the like that I do not believe he's really referring to as necessary to be confessed. But there are some things that I would like to just mention here today with you that I think are essential or important. First of all, I'd like to mention wrongs done to a brother or to another individual, another person, a brother or sister, you might say, in your family or elsewhere others, that you have done wrong to. We act unjustly, maybe by accusing them falsely or by slander. That must be dealt with. Go to that individual and say, look, I'm sorry. I slandered your name. I shouldn't have done it. And I'm sorry about it. I want to deal with it and I want to confess it. We should confess our fault to that individual and ask for forgiveness. Make all possible means for repair or to amend that gap or that situation. All quarrels among brethren should be dealt with. For example, we read in the book of Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 23 and 24, that before they were to celebrate the Lord's Supper, he says there that all quarrels among the brethren were to be made up in the spirit of Christian love before they were to partake of the Lord's Supper. The second type of sin that I believe is important to confess both before God and man are scandalous sins. Sins which bring reproach even to the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice, discipline is an ordinance of God, and to conserve the purity of the church and to the group of believers, this is important. If anyone falls into a gross or to an open sin, that must be dealt with. It must be confessed. Public confession in the church is necessary in instances like that, with a scandalous sin. Notice what David did. David was caught in immorality with Bathsheba. He took and he committed not only adultery, but he sanctioned in Uriah's death. And notice how the prophet came and said, David, you're the man. Notice how we have it written in Scripture, how David confessed this scandalous sin. Now, notice, I even know of those who had to leave the pulpit because of wrong living, and who later were reinstated. And this is right and this is proper. Sin must be dealt with in a right way. The third type that I believe is necessary for confession is where the sin has deeply wounded the conscience of another. For example, you are disturbed by doing something towards another individual. You hurt the other person. Notice how sensitive Paul was. Maybe it's a habit you have that God is trying to deal with. You're hurting your family. You're hurting those that you're with or someone else. And you don't want to let go of that habit. And God says, I want you to do so. These types of things must be dealt with. If you deeply wound their conscience, deal with that thing. Think of Paul, for example, who was so sensitive. He said, if it hinders someone that I eat meat,
I won't even do it. I'll read it for you. 1 Corinthians 8:13, he says, therefore, if what I eat causes my brother to fall in sin, I will never eat meat again, so that I will not cause him to fall. My, what a sensitive conscience and spirit he had. And we do well to pray with and for one another along the same line, so that God can set us free from spiritual selfishness, and so that we can develop within us, by the grace of God, even sympathy for others. And the last thing I'd like to mention is prayer is a powerful thing. Think of Elijah and what we read here, who prayed that it wouldn't rain, and for 3.5 years it did not rain. One man with God is a majority, we can truly say. Remember up there on the Mount of Carmel, where he had 450 Baal prophets and 400 prophets of Asherah? They prayed all day long, and no answer came. Well, after Elijah prayed, the rain, they had put water on the offering and everything, and God, he struck with fire, and everything was consumed. Notice what he said to Ahab. Go and say to Ahab, prepare your chariot and go down, lest the rain stop you. Oh yeah, what a power there is in prayer. We have many examples of that in the scripture. Peter, who was in prison, the church was earnestly in prayer to God for him, it says in Acts 12:5. For example, a woman who came to Jesus, who had a daughter who was suffering terribly, while the Lord healed her, it says in Matthew 15:22. So you have the right to pray. Do it, my friend, and do it according to the word of God. If sin must be dealt with in your life today, deal with it. Let's just pray about that. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that you have given us to pray, talk with you openly in prayer. Maybe there's someone here, Lord, listening today that knows within their own heart they haven't dealt right with sin. Maybe sin has to be confessed to a neighbor, to a son, to a daughter, to a wife. A scandalous sin, a sin that has caused damage or hurt to someone else's conscience, and they're holding back, not willing to confess. God, deal with that type of a person today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
By the way, I just about forgot to announce that our song of the month is God Leads His Dear Children Along. Be sure to ask for a copy of Words and Music. There's time today for only the chorus. Write to Lutheran Gospel Hour, Box 12, Pasadena, California. And in Canada, Box 201, Saskatoon, Saskatchewan.
Some through the waters, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood.
You have been listening to the Lutheran Gospel Hour, Post Office Box 12, Pasadena, California. And listeners in Canada should write to the Lutheran Gospel Hour, Box 201, Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. This is Pastor R. Norheim, inviting you to tune in again next week, same time, same station.